Well, I think I know most of you guys, but yeah, I'm Tony, as Justin said. And yeah, part of a little bit of what I do is Uber driving. I have a full-time permanent job, but I just do this as a bit of a sideline for extra coins, which everybody can, and I think most that do Uber driving do that. But this is not really to do with that side of it, but just a bit of the technology of what's happening behind the scenes. Because on the surface, basically, you think, okay, you want a taxi type setup, you get that taxi either via app or on phone or whatever else. But there's a little bit more behind it with the Uber side of things. So we'll just so basically, the basic principles behind ride sharing, I'll show in a movie that I've just. We'll queue up in a minute. It's only about a 4.5 minute movie that demonstrates how both the apps work. So it's, for those of you who don't really know, and this will just be a bit of a preview into the movie, it's all app driven. So you need to have a smartphone, you need to have the app downloaded on the smartphone for you to use the Uber service. It's been around since around 2009, starting in San Francisco, I believe, so it's been around for a little while. But we'll just watch this film and then we'll talk a bit more.
So now we're going to show you how Uber works for the driver and the passenger. So today, I get to be the Uber passenger, and Philip here is going to be our Uber driver.
I am ready to start my shift as the driver. So the first thing I'm going to do is open the Uber app, and then I'm going to go online by tapping here. And it's going to show me on the map, sometimes there are surge areas where there's a high demand, and that simply means that the prices have increased to attract drivers to those areas. So I can decide if I want to stay where I am and maybe find someone closer or drive there and possibly make some extra cash.
So I'm going to click on the Uber app here, which I downloaded for free in the App Store. You can then either manually enter your address or move the pin around until you get it where you want it. This is also your chance to choose which Uber service you want. So if you want to do Uber Pool or Uber Select, or in our case today, standard Uber X. Once that's done, you're going to set pickup location.
So since I know that Brenton is about to send a request, it's going to come to me because I am the closest to him. It's all based on location. And there's his request. So it's going to give me 15 seconds to accept, or it'll time out and go to the next driver. So we don't want that to happen. So we'll go ahead and accept it by tapping anywhere on the screen. And his address shows up here, so we're going to tap on Navigate, and we're ready to go pick up Brenton.
You also have the option to enter your destination so that the driver knows where you're going, and you get an estimated fare. Today, we're heading to an ice cream shop for my first day, because I don't want to come on too strong and look like I'm trying too hard, so I want to, like, keep it simple and easy. Anyway, you're going to already have your credit card info linked to your account, so all you have to do is request UberX. And now you can see which driver accepted your request, which in our case today is Philip. It's going to show you their name and their photo, what kind of car they're driving, and their license plate number. This is all extremely important because the last thing you want to do is get in the wrong car. It's also going to show you the approximate number of minutes it's going to take for them to get to you. So we wait.
So as we're getting close to the destination, it's going to automatically switch back to the Uber app and show that I'm arriving. So it looks like this is it right here. And there's Brenton.
All right, so it looks like our Uber driver is here, so let's go for a ride.
So now that I have my passenger in the car, I'm just going to slide to begin the trip. And now it shows me his destination. So once again, I'm going to tap on Navigate, and we are ready to head out. Sometimes as you're arriving at the destination, even before you've dropped off your passenger, you'll get a request from another rider. Since we're doing a tutorial, I can't accept this one, so I'm just going to let it time out. Alright, so now that we've dropped off Brenton, I'm going to end the trip by swiping here, and it's going to prompt me to give him a rating, so of course I'll give him his 5 stars, and slide to confirm. And it's going to take me back online, ready to accept my next trip. Now, because of that trip that I had to ignore earlier, it's going to give me a little notification down here just saying that I missed out on some extra earnings. Since I'm not going to continue driving today, I'm going to go offline by tapping up here. And we're all done.
So once you get to your destination, all you gotta do is get out of the car. Everything is paid for through the credit card you have connected to your account. And you don't have to take it, but you can if you want to. But I'm gonna hold on to this because I need this for my date. Sorry, Phil. On my phone, you can see the cost of the trip, which was $5.15. And I had the chance to rate my driver. Let's give Philip 2 stars. Just kidding, 5 stars for Philip. And that's it. Easy breezy. Now for the hard part, which is this date. I wish there was a video tutorial on how to make a good first impression.
There are 3 basic requirements if you're interested in becoming an Uber driver. Be 21 years old, pass a DMV and background check, and own a car that's insured and meets the Uber standards. We'll have a link in the description for more details.
It's so simple, right? Click below to subscribe to this YouTube channel, and don't forget to visit idrivewithuber.com for more info.
Very slick Google.
So there was lots of Google. A couple bits about that video that weren't quite accurate. One is that the closest driver doesn't necessarily get the job, but we'll cover that in a moment. But the rest of it was fairly close. So yeah, how does a rider get matched with a driver? Is it as simple as the closest car being matched up to the closest passenger? Well, a lot of the times, no, that's not the case. Right, so as you saw on the app, on the video, that's what a passenger would see if they want to get an Uber. They'll see lots of little cars all hopping around Hobart City there, and they think, yeah, okay, I want to get an Uber. Another little bit of technology that happens is that Google Maps, and some of the IT people you may know or would know a whole lot more about this than I, but apparently Uber paid for what's called a premium API or something similar. Is anyone to do with data? Google data? Yep.
Yep.
So basically, the fastest information as to road conditions, traffic, and road blockages, road closures, things like that, afforded to an Uber driver through the Google Maps, more so than the free version, because Uber pay Google to get the real-time faster sort of data than the average punter. Another thing about being matched up with driver to the rider is Hobart Airport. This is just before we get into a bit more of the in-depth stuff. So this screen here is showing us Hobart Airport, and it's showing that there's a queue system in place, which happens at Hobart Airport. So unlike the traditional taxis who line up on a taxi rank, one behind the other, as you enter the airport precinct, you'll be slotted into a virtual queue, regardless of where you park in the airport area. So on that occasion, I was in position number 2. So one other car gets a job, and then the next one's mine. But I only ever really hang around the airport if I'd used another app, say like Flight Radar 24, and saw that there was a plane already landed or about to land. Otherwise, it's not really worth hanging around, you know, hour or so to get a $25 job back to the city when you can do a 10-minute drive and be back earning money again. Right, so does the closest car always pick up the closest passengers? Some factors that may alter this is the, I think, called a minimum fare guarantee for drivers, which we'll touch on in a moment. Also, a patience tolerance for passengers. We'll touch on that as well. And previous matchups of drivers and riders and the rating system. So minimum fare guarantees. So Uber, to try and get the most amount of cars on the road when the most amount of passengers are going to be wanting rides, which will keep their service alive and healthy, they offer incentives. That's the current week that we're looking at there, of when to be on the road, and they're going to offer a minimum guarantee of wages per hour based on being online during those times. But to qualify for those rates, you need to do an average of 1.5 jobs an hour, which isn't that hard to achieve. So as soon as you really got your first or second job out of the way, and they might have only been $4 or $5 jobs, you have to say $10, $11 for the hour, but you're still sort of a fair bit shy of $35 an hour. So you can sort of back it in that you're going to end up with an airport job sort of pretty soon after that. So, just say, for instance, I'm here where I am right now, and there's an Uber car driver just down by the barbecue area having a bit of a spell, but still logged on. He's already achieved $45 for the hour, and he's really close to me. He's only a minute from picking me up. But Jim blogs, he's down by the Botanical Gardens, and he's only got his $11 so far for the hour. He'll end up with the job, even though he's not the closest and most appropriate driver, simply because Uber would rather that the public will bump up his hourly rate rather than Uber having to dig out of their own pockets, because that's essentially what happens. If you don't meet the minimum hourly rate out of fares, they will subsidise your pay, so that they'd rather avoid that. So that factor leads to that, where and the same happens in the city, even further afield. Many cars at Salamanca, all of them might have had really big hours, so they've all reached their limits for the hour to meet the minimum guarantee. A car that's sitting out in Newtown may get the job from Salamanca to the airport simply to bump them up. So it's sort of a bit of skullduggery happens on that front. The next one is patience, tolerance of the rider. So this is trying to demonstrate an impatient person, a patient person, and please forgive my choice of pictures. So basically, if you're an impatient type of person, Uber can see when you open up the app, they can see that what the delay time is before the Uber's going to get to you, and you go, can't be bothered with that, so you close it down, and they presume you've grabbed a taxi or phoned a friend or whatever else. So they're going to then put a score against your name that shows that you're a fairly intolerant passenger, and in effect you're going to get priority over somebody who's a bit more chilled, like our snoozer on the side there, who's happy to look at his app and go, yeah, 12 minute wait, I'll have another coffee while I'm waiting for my Uber and accept the ride. So they're always going to put him on the back burner while he remains on that score, and the impatient person will bit of a cruel world, isn't it? Yeah, so that's another factor that leads to which car may also pick up which rider, because it may be that person has actually achieved their hourly rate, but they don't want to lose a rider, so things sort of get thrown around a little bit. Previous interactions with star ratings. Uber don't like to have it so that people that have had a bad or indifferent experience with a driver, or if the driver has not really sort of meshed well with the passenger and they've sort of scored each other anything other than 5 stars, they won't match up those two again. So you may be very close to that person, you may only be a block away, but there's every likelihood that somebody many blocks away will get the job, simply because they don't want either the driver to be discontent or the passenger not to be happy for a second time based on a previous experience that they've had with their Uber. So as you can see, it's not just as simple as matching up with the closest possible car. They touched on the surging before in that video clip that we saw. So here's some screenshots of the Hobart area. And when I've got my app open, basically I'm seeing a map like the centre one that shows me the hot spots around Hobart where people are prepared to pay more than the norm for their trip home. And I don't know if you can read whether it's clear over the distance or not, but you can see some 1.6, 1.5 multipliers around different streets of the city from the zoomed in of that area there. So what they're saying is that people are accepting jobs that instead of being, say, a $20 fare to get home, they're prepared to pay $30 or $35 to get home for exactly the same ride, simply because demand is far outdoing what's available for the supply.
So, Tony, the passenger on their app is able to actually say, I'm prepared to pay.
Absolutely, that's how it happens. So they're using their passenger app, yep, and they're putting in where they're going home to, and the app says, hey, prices are slightly higher than normal at the moment due to increasing demand. It's going to cost you $35. And they go, oh, that only usually cost me $15. So they go, yeah, but I'm keen to get home. I'll accept it. And then it says, are you sure? Prices are high. Yeah, I'm still sure. And then you get matched up. So that stops the gripes that afterwards, oh, geez, I was charged more than I should have done.
Is there an upper threshold, or does it just keep going?
About 3 times is about the highest it gets.
Okay.
which is a fair whack. If I was to go from the city to my house at Granton,
yep.
that's about usually about a $39 fare according to the app. But when it's Ooh. In the real hot red zone, it'll be $100-something fare to get from the city to Granton.
Yeah.
So if you're pretty keen to get home.
Yep.
Yeah.
How does that compare with the standard taxi fare?
Still heaps more. Yeah. Generally, Uber is probably only about 2/3 of a taxi fare normally. But when a surging happens, it's way dearer than a cab. But people are still prepared to pay.
That's because you can't get a cab.
Actually, sometimes the opposite is true. Like at Salamanca on a Friday and Saturday night, all down Castro Esplanade may be absolutely chockers with taxis that wrapped around the corner into Salamanca Place, and people are waiting 10, 15 minutes for an Uber. And here's all these taxis just sitting there. And with surges happening. So one has to wonder why they are so discontent with jumping into a taxi as opposed to waiting for an Uber at an elevated price. It's a bit bizarre. I often tell people that they say, oh, this has cost me a fortune. I say, yeah, just have another coffee and wait 10 minutes because the surge will disappear.
Mm. And that's, to be honest, if people knew more how it worked, I think you'd probably even get more. I mean, I had a taxi driver this morning from Luna that managed to take me all the way down Main Street, almost to the mall, before he realised that he couldn't get to Morrison Street by going straight down Elizabeth Street. So it took half an hour to get from Luna to Morrison Street, whereas your little app would have showed you that's not a good way to go, because it's really busy along there and 8 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah. I haven't covered this bit with a slide, but what Uber are really big on is using their Navigate feature, like you saw on the video clip, where you use their Navigate feature to get after you pick up the passenger from point A to point B. So then there can't be any contentious arguments about, oh, you took me the wrong way, because through that advanced data that Google are providing Uber, it's showing you where the hotspots are. It's rerouting you the whole way. It might be showing you the normal way you go, and it'll come up in grey saying it's 5 minutes slower, and it will be saying do a left here, do a right there, and it's going to send you around the traffic areas.
Fantastic.
Yeah, but it's also good for doing the pickup as well, because an example of that, I was down Churchill Avenue type way, and I had a job at Cascade Road. I'm thinking, okay, the normal way I'd go if I was just normally driving around would be to head somewhere towards, say, the Aberfeldy Hotel and then up Davey Street, but it shot me over Proctors Road, up Linton Avenue, down on Darcy Street, and I was there in a flash. I'm thinking, yeah, that sort of made sense. I wouldn't have thought that myself off the top of my head, but yeah. So that's,
It's not the Aberfeldy anymore.
I think most of us rolled up to it.
We all knew what you were talking about, though. Yeah.
So another thing that both keep an eye on, that's what Justin was just talking about. It shows the pricing there of if someone wanted to go from the city to Mount Field, but I don't know who would want to do that, but what the price would be worth. And from the driver side of things, it shows the most recent job of what the fare was worth. Like in that case, it was $37. And after Uber take their chunk, it was worth $27.79 for me to take these people from Liverpool Street down to 7 Mile Beach.
I thought you said you had a job to Mount Field.
Yeah, so some tourists from Hong Kong decided they wanted to visit Russell Falls. So yeah, I did. I took them up there and brought them back again. But I was left a little bit out of pocket because Mount Field's not in the Uber service area, so I had to wait until we got back to New Norfolk before they could request me as a driver again. So they got half of the return trip for free, so that's the way it goes sometimes. Just another slide that I don't have, which is, I think, an important one. What people really like about the Uber apps is the anonymity side of things. After the ride is finished, I don't retain any details of that person's name or address that I took them to. I'll see a rough mud map like that as to where I started and where I finished off at, but no real detail. They can call me if they want, if they're having a hard time finding where I'm parked, but I don't see their number. It would only come up as a gateway number through a Sydney 02 type number. And if I want to call them to say, hey, I'm outside of Irish Murphy's, I can't find you, they don't see my number either. They only see a Sydney-based number coming through to their phone. So if there is any sort of issues with the transport either way, there's no way really of ever being able to cross paths again with them from the info you gain from that trip.
Tony, from the finance point of view, and you might cover this, sir, from the finance point of view, Does Uber check that they have enough credit? Because that would be the other issue.
Because they're using a credit card,
yep.
I guess that part of it's guaranteed from Uber side of things, because
yeah, okay.
they'll hit the provider, like MasterCard
yep.
or Visa, for the money.
And it's at the beginning of the trip.
Yeah, that's it.
So, okay.
It's like buying fuel from an automatic machine. They check the value first, make sure there's credit.
Yeah.
Then to say, oh, I need 50 of that $70, is that okay? Yeah.
And part of the sign-up agreement is, I haven't read it for certain, but for the user, it could even be that at the start of the trip, if it's estimating perhaps a $40 fare, that it may be putting a freeze on that $40, a bit like a car rental company does or a hotel does, and then takes what it needs at the end of it and releases the rest sort of thing, but I'm not sure about that.
Okay.
Tony, how's the fare actually calculated? Is it calculated before you... Is it a set fare when you get...
Yeah. When you as a rider decide that you want to grab an Uber, whatever price you're given then, which will be a range that usually about $6 or $8 either side within a range, it will tell you what the price is and it won't deviate from that. And from my experience, it's always been on the lower end. They factor in just a couple of little things in case...
Right, so if you do get held up in traffic, the price does go up a bit?
Very slightly only. It's 35 cents a minute while standing still. So, if you was 10 minutes sitting there in the one spot, it's only $3.50, which will probably fall well and truly within that range that the app has worked out for you. And that's worked it out on that Google data that's already been pumped out. So all of it's so intertwined that it's a very smart system.
Interesting algorithms going on here.
To be honest, I've sort of dwelled over these apps a fair bit, and I can't think of a way that they could improve upon them at the moment of how smart that they all run in conjunction with each other. Right, okay, that's the end of the slides that I've got. Questions?
Sorry,
how do you fare in the end, fuel-wise? You get a fuel allowance based on what you've spent, what you've earned?
No, you're a contractor, so to speak, to Uber, so basically that comes out of your earnings. The fuel part of it's all is up in a bit of a tax deduction, so...
Is there any allowance made for the type of car and the...
No, there isn't, which is a bit of an oddity in Hobart, because we're such a small market. Some of them might have a Nissan Micra, I think Nissan make Micras there, but they may have one of those, very fuel efficient, run on a oily rag, and not as big and as comfortable, say, as an SUV, and you could end up with either car. But in other markets where it's a bigger market, you get the choice between you want a small car that's cheap and affordable, or an SUV, or a larger car, or a black, or whatever else, but Hobart's just not big enough yet for that. So. It could be something that they introduce in time.
Is there a green, hybrid option?
No, not at the moment, no.
Because that was a big thing in taxi service.
Yeah, so a friend of mine who works in IT in Sydney for a bank, but he ended up buying a Tesla and joining Uber Black. So he gets premium fares and that way he's, paying off his Tesla.
Yeah.
In the mainland capitals, they actually have Uber have leasing programs in place where you can lease a vehicle from the mothership and they're mostly very affordable type of cars like that that's giving you best bang for buck for being on the road.
Tony, when you order a car, do you have to put down how many passengers you've got?
No, there is a requirement though that you're able to seat four passengers.
Oh, right.
So, it's between one and four passengers, but any more than that, if you've got a bigger vehicle that can take it, you can actually tell Uber that I took six passengers in my Tarago van, and they will back charge the person some more for the extra passengers.
Yeah. Right, so you can order it, you can, on the app you can order
no,
it.
No, no, what you probably need to do is have a look at which car's coming your way, and then probably cancel that trip within the first 5 minutes so you don't get charged the cancellation fee, and put down the reason that you require a bigger vehicle for more passengers as the reason why you cancelled the trip with that particular car.
Yeah.
And then they'll send the car with more seats?
You'd hope that would be what the what would happen. I thought that it would basically probably just be computers in the background just doing most of the work, but in Docklands area of Melbourne, it's quite a big area there with maybe 15, 20 people working behind consoles, just monitoring the urban movements around Australia, which quite surprised me, to be honest.
Any idea about how many drivers there are sort of in a place the size of Hobart?
I'm told at the moment there's about 200.
Okay.
Yeah, which surprised me. I didn't think there'd be that many. Yeah.
Okay.
But
cool.
Even with that many, people still complain that there doesn't seem to be enough cars for the demand that they want at various times of the day.
Not 200. So how many
at the same time?
No.
Right.
So how many on the ride at any one time?
Hard to tell, because as a rider, you'd only ever see the closest 10 cars, so you wouldn't know how many more are outside of that area. Yeah.
Do you have any idea, like you say, you do it on the side, so say maybe two evenings in the week. Are there many like that, do you know other drivers that just do it full time as a main income?
I don't know if many do it full time, to be honest. I haven't spoken to any, but I believe some would. I've picked up some tourists who have been with other Uber drivers during the day who've been told that that they do operate full time. And there's a bit of a market for people during the day with the cruise ships, from what I'm told, where they just say just keep driving. And they're on that ship called the World or whatever else, and they're just driving around southern Tasmania for the day.
Do you get a chance to catch up with other Uber drivers?
No, generally not.
Mm-hmm.
I know personally just a couple that I know who they are. They're friends of mine. That just during conversation, they told me that they were doing the Uber thing. But yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but you generally do see the same cars around Salamanca and waiting in the same areas.
I've used Uber in Melbourne to go to the airport and stuff, and a couple of those drivers are pretty much driving full time.
Yeah.
But my son uses Uber as a courier service because he has media stuff that ends up being pretty hot and close to deadline. So he calls an Uber, walks downstairs when the guy's downstairs, gives him the hard drive. He drives over to wherever it's supposed to be delivered, and by the time he gets there, the guy's walking downstairs, and it just goes very quickly.
Right, yeah.
So they've given up with the bike messengers or motorcycle messengers or whatever else they have.
Yeah.
And they know when it's coming, so the guy can stay in his work post until it's right downstairs.
It's all trackable and very affordable.
Yeah, and it's just bing-bang zoom. Yeah. It's really efficient.
Yeah, and as you may have heard, on the mainland they have Uber Eats now, where you basically just choose food off a menu from a takeaway shop, and an Uber gets dispatched to go and pick up your takeaway and runs it home for you. Yeah,
you know?
And that's separate to Uber passenger vehicles, because they've got like insulated satchels, all sorts of things, and all that. Yeah, so the whole thing's growing the whole time.
I was going to ask about goods transfer, because even 20 years ago it was common to drop something off to a taxi driver to take it elsewhere, news coverage or whatever, parcels, papers, without the actual passenger being there.
Yeah.
It was always a bit complicated because you had to run an account that was approved and all the rest of it. So you didn't have the ability back then to prepay by credit card or anything like that.
Yeah.
It was always post-event, and there's always the danger it wouldn't work. So now I can see that if Uber's willing to take that work on, it's going to be a whole lot easier for that.
Yeah.
Say, right, $50 allowance or whatever on the call, and get charged $39 when it's finished.
Yeah.
But I wasn't sure whether Uber would do that.
No, I'm guessing it's something that will happen before time. I think unofficially some people may use Uber now as a bit of a courier service for certain services and deliveries of other items. I picked up a guy just from not a street address but just on the Brooker, and took him to a place in Lena Valley, then took him back to that side of the road in the Brooker again. Ask no questions.
Yeah.
And he might have been dropping off a DVD bar, who knows, but yeah. Yeah.
Any other questions for Tony?
Well, thanks for listening, guys, and I hope you enjoyed it.
That's right.
We'll take a short break while we set up for Scott. Grab a coffee or anything, and we'll get underway in a few minutes' time.